Okay. Yesterday we had discussed this result. Let S be a linearly independent subset of a vector space V, and T be a spanning set . I also assume that S has finitely many elements as well as T. S is U1, U2, etc. UM, and T is V1, V2, etc. VN. Okay. Then what we had shown yesterday was that M is less than or equal to N. Okay, let's use this result and prove that any two bases for a finite dimensional vector space will have the same number of elements. So let's consider the following. I want to prove this theorem. Let S and T be basis for a vector space V with S equal to U1, U2, etc., UM, and T equals V1, V2, etc., VN. That is, I have two finite sets that are basis for a vector space V. Then they must have the same number of elements. That is the conclusion. Then M is equal to N. Okay, two finite subsets of a vector space V, if they satisfy the condition that they are basis for the vector space, then they must have the same number of elements. Okay, the proof will use this result that I stated just now. Now S is a basis, so S is linearly independent. S is a basis, so it must be a spanning set as well as a linearly independent set. S is linearly independent. Similarly, T. I will exploit the fact that S is linearly independent and the fact that T is a spanning set. By the above result, it follows that M is less than or equal to N. Okay, the next part is to reverse the roles of S and T. S is a spanning set, T is a linearly independent set. The number of elements in T must be less than or equal to the number of elements of S. So let me just say, similarly, N is less than or equal to M, and so M is equal to N. Okay, so the number of elements in any finite basis, the number of elements in any two finite bases is the same. Okay, so this leads to the definition of the dimension. Let V be a vector space with a finite basis . The dimension of V is the number of elements in any basis of V. So this is a definition of the dimension of a vector space. This number is unique by the previous theorem. This number is unique, and so this notion is well defined. Okay, if V does not have a finite basis, if V does not have a finite basis, then V is said to be infinite dimensional. If V does not have a finite basis, then V is said to be infinite dimensional. Look at the trivial vector space. V equal to 0 is 0 dimensional. Okay, the only vector space which is 0 dimensional is the trivial space, singleton 0. See, remember, it cannot be one dimensional, because if it is one dimensional, then the basis will have precisely one element, and this one vector cannot be 0, because it must be linearly independent, and so this cannot be one dimensional, it is 0 dimensional. Okay, let us then look at familiar examples of vector spaces that we have seen before and determine their dimensions. Examples, the first one is Rn. For Rn, we had written down the standard basis in the last lecture. I will call this B. B is E1, E2, etc., En, where E1, E2, etc., En are the vectors that were defined in the last lecture. This is a basis. This is a basis for Rn, and it is called the standard basis of Rn. This is called the standard basis of Rn. Okay, example 2, let us look at the space of polynomials of degree k. For this, look at the collection P0, P1, etc., Pk, where this was also defined before, where Pi of t is t to the I. 0 less than or equal to I less than or equal to k, t is a real variable. So this set of polynomials, they are k in number. This set is a basis, and so the dimension of Pk is k plus 1. There are k plus 1 vectors in that basis. Okay. What is the dimension of C01? C01 is a space of all complex valued continuous functions on the interval 0, 1. What is the dimension of this space? This is infinite dimensional. So what is the argument for that? This is infinite dimensional. See, the reason is as follows. Let us take the polynomials that we have defined earlier. Define P0, P1, etc. by Pi of t equals t to the I. This time t varies in 0, 1. Define these polynomials, that is 1t, t square, etc. Now this is an infinite subset. Consider P0, P1, P2, etc., Pk, etc. This is an infinite subset. I am claiming that this infinite subset is linearly independent. Now we had seen this definition yesterday, that an infinite subset is linearly independent if and only if every finite subset of it is linearly independent, okay. Okay, so we need to show that every finite subset of this is linearly independent. But is that something that we have proved before? Take a finite subset, okay. Let us say I have the polynomials 1, t square, t power 100, let us say t power 1000. Then can we show that this is linearly independent? You look at a linear combination, equate that to 0, differentiate as many times as you want, show that the coefficients are 0, okay. Same idea that we used earlier can be used here to show that this is an infinite subset. Linearly independent subset. This is linearly independent. This is a linearly independent subset of C01. Every polynomial function is continuous. Okay, so these are first members in C01. Now can you get a contradiction? If there is a finite basis, if there is a finite basis, then the previous theorem would be contradicted. So this cannot have a finite basis, okay. The number of if it is finite dimensional, then the number of elements in any two bases will be the same, but we need to use a lesser known fact, which is if you have a linearly independent subset and a spanning set, then the number of elements in the spanning set must be greater than or equal to number of elements in the spanning set must be greater than or equal to the number of elements in the linearly independent set. That is clearly not possible here. If it has a finite basis, then this is clearly violated, okay. So there is no finite basis. For this vector space, okay, I have given the reasoning, we'll fill up the details here. If it has a finite basis, then this would violate the inequality m less than or equal to n. Okay, so this is an example of an infinite dimensional vector space. Let's also prove a few more consequences of the previous result. Let V be a finite dimensional vector space. That is, V has a finite basis. Let S be a subset of V, then we have the following. If S is linearly independent, then the number of elements of S cannot exceed the dimension of V. If S is linearly independent, then the number of elements in S, this is the cardinality of S, that cannot exceed the dimension of V. This stands for the dimension. This notation will be used for denoting the dimension. That is one property. Property 2, if dimension of V is less than the number of elements in any linearly independent subset, in any subset S, then yes, S is linearly dependent. Okay, you will immediately notice that statement B is the contrapositive equivalence of statement A. So statement B doesn't really need to be proved. Condition C, if S is property C rather, if S is linearly if S equals let us say u1, u2, etcetera, un with n denoting the dimension of V, if this S is linearly independent, that is I take a subset which is which has n elements where n is the dimension of the vector space, then if it is linearly independent then it must be a spanning set, then S is a spanning set. Of the vector space V. Okay, a linearly independent subset having the same number of elements as any basis would have has to be a basis. A linearly independent subset having the same number of elements as that of a basis of a finite dimensional vector space must be a basis. Okay, that is property C. Okay, proof. The first one is something we have already proved. Okay, you have to just put the framework there. Let us take dimension of V to be n. This will be useful in part C also. And write S as u1, u2, etcetera. Okay, let us say V1, V2, etcetera, Vm. Then we have seen earlier that if S is linearly independent, if S is linearly independent, then the number of elements in S, that is M, that cannot exceed the number of elements in any basis of V. M is less than or equal to the number of elements in any basis of V. This we have seen before. But what is the number of elements in any basis of V? That is precisely n, because any basis will have n elements since the dimension of V is n. Okay, so this number is n. So M is less than or equal to n. That is condition A holds, property A holds. The number of elements in any linearly independent subset cannot exceed the dimension of the vector space. B is the contrapositive equivalence. So I will simply say B is equivalent to A. So no proof for that. Property C. S is given to be u1, u2, etcetera, un, where n is a dimension of V. We must show that S is a spanning set. Suppose S is not a spanning set, we will get a contradiction. Okay. Okay. If span of S is not equal to V, we want to show that S is a spanning set for the vector space V. Which means we must show that span of S is equal to V. If span of S is not equal to V, then there exists a vector, let us call it X. X is in V such that X does not belong to span of S. I have two sets which are not equal, and one is contained in the other. Span of S is always contained in V. That's a subspace, in fact. Okay, we have seen. So one is a subset of the other, but the two sets are not equal, which means the superset has an element which does not belong to that subset. There exists an X in V such that X doesn't belong to span S. I look at this set S union X. Okay, include this X, define a new set. This has these elements u1, u2, etc., un, and X. Now, since X does not belong to span of S, what it means is that X is not a linear combination of the preceding vectors. X is not a linear combination of u1, u2, etc., un. So this is a linearly independent set. This is linearly independent. Okay. Let's recall the argument. If this set S union X were linearly dependent, then there is at least one vector which is a linear combination of the preceding vectors. Now that cannot happen for u1, u2, etc., un because they are already linearly independent. So the only possibility if this set is linearly independent is that this X is a linear combination of u1, u2, etc., un. We know that is not possible because X doesn't belong to span V. So this set must be linearly independent. Now this is linearly independent and the number of elements here is n plus 1. So that cannot exceed n, but this is a greater number and so you have a contradiction and so this cannot happen. That is X, there is no X in V which does not belong to span V. The number of elements in the set S union X, this is n plus 1. This is greater than n, which is the dimension of V. This contradicts, this is a contradiction to property A that we proved just now. The number of elements in the any linearly independent subset cannot exceed the dimension of the vector space. This is a contradiction, and so there exists no X in V such that X does not belong to span of S. That is, S is a spanning set of V. That is, S is a basis of the vector space V. Okay, so you can. This is what we say, the dimension is the number of elements in any maximal linearly independent subset or the number of elements in any minimal spanning set. Okay. Let's now look at some examples of subspaces and determine their dimensions. Okay, examples of subspaces, their dimensions. Let's first look at R2. Okay, let's say I start with R3. Consider R3. Look at the following subspace. The set of all X in R3 such that AX1 plus BX2 plus CX3 equals 0 for given constants ABC. look at the collection of all x that satisfy this single condition. What we know is that this is a certain plane passing through the origin. The constant term is 0. This is a plane passing through the origin. We have verified earlier that this is a subspace. Okay, let's determine its dimension. Let's determine the dimension of this subset that is a plane in R3. Intuitively, we know that the dimension must be 2. So let's prove that this has a basis consisting of precisely 2 vectors. Okay. Okay. Without loss of generality, let's assume that A is not 0. At least one of these constants must be non-zero. Okay. This is a non-degenerate plane, non-trivial plane. So take A to be non-zero, then I can write x1 as minus b by ax2 minus c by ax3. Remember, I started with a single equation, ax1 plus bx2 plus cx3 is 0. Single equation and 3 unknowns, x1, x2, x3, a, b, c are given constants. So I can fix one of them and determine, I can fix two of them, determine one in terms of the other two. So I have fixed x2 and x3, determining x1 in terms of x2 and x3. Then any vector x in W can be written as x is x1, x2, x3, that is x1 is minus b by ax2 minus c by ax3, x2, x3 are arbitrary. This can be rewritten as minus, let's say x2 into minus b by a 1 0 plus x3 into minus c by a 0 1. See, all that I have done is to write x as a linear combination of these two vectors. Let's call this as v1, this as v2. Set v1 to be minus b by a 1 0. This time I am writing the vectors as row vectors. Set v1 to be this and v2 to be minus c by a 0 1. Okay. Then what is the claim? The claim is that these two vectors form a basis for W. So this must, this, these two vectors must be linearly independent and they span W. Okay. The fact that these two vectors span W has been demonstrated here. Any x in W can be written as a linear combination of V1 and V2. Is that okay? That is, in this notation, this is equal to x2 V1 plus x3 V2. I have written any x in W as a linear combination of V1 and V2. And so this is a spanning set. These two span W is clear. Linear independence, are they linearly independent? One is not a multiple of the other. So these are obviously linearly independent. Clearly, V1, V2 are linearly independent. And so I have a basis. Okay. V1, V2 is a basis of the subspace W, which is a plane passing through the origin. So the dimension of any plane passing through the origin is 2. So dimension of W equals 2. Okay. We also prove the converse. The converse is true. If the dimension of a subspace is 2, then it must be a certain plane passing through the origin. Okay, so let's prove that. That is, we are determining subspaces of dimension 2 precisely. Okay, we are saying that in R3, if a subspace has dimension 2, then it must be a plane passing through the origin. And what we have just now shown is that if it is a plane passing through the origin, then its dimension is 2. Okay. So this is complete understanding of two-dimensional subspaces of R3. Okay, so the converse is what I want to show next. Conversely, let's show that if W is a subspace of dimension 2, then W is a plane passing through the origin. Okay. Okay, so let's look at W and call a basis B of W consisting of elements UV. This B a basis of W. I know that there are two elements because the dimension is 2. I must show that this W is a plane passing through the origin. Okay, let's take X and W. I'll take an arbitrary point in W. I will show that this arbitrary point satisfies the equation of a plane. Okay, I'll show that this point satisfies the equation of a plane. So it follows that any point in W must lie on the plane. And it will then follow that these two are the same. Okay, let's look at okay, before that let me write down X as a linear combination. X is let's say alpha times U plus beta times V. Let me use coordinates U equal to U1, U2, U3. V equals V1, V2, V3. And X is equal to X1, X2, X3. Okay. So I have X1, X2, X3 being equal to alpha times U1, alpha U2, alpha U3 plus beta V1, beta V2, beta V3. This is my X. That is X1 equals alpha U1 plus beta V1. X2 equals alpha U2 plus beta V2. X3 is alpha U3 plus beta V3. Any X in V is a linear combination, any X in W is a linear combination of the vectors U and V. I have written down the expanded form of the coordinates of X, of the components of X. Let me also define a new vector. I will call that as the vector Z. Let me define a new vector Z to be the cross product of U and V. Z is a cross product of U and V. Remember that U and V are basis vectors, so none of them is 0, none of them is 0, one is not a multiple of the other, and so U cross V must be perpendicular to both U and V. Okay, vector calculus, Z is perpendicular, the vector Z that we have defined is perpendicular to U and V, then perpendicularity is what A dot B equal to 0, and for 3 dimensional vectors A dot B is the component wise multiplication and then addition, A1 B1 plus A2 B2 plus A3 B3. So what I have is Z dot U is 0 as well as Z dot V, that is Z1 U1 plus Z2 U2 plus Z3 U3. This is 0 as well as the corresponding equation for Z dot V equal to 0. Z1 V1 plus Z2 V2 plus Z3 V3. This is 0. Okay, this Z is perpendicular to U and V. Now U and V are plane vectors. Z is perpendicular to U and V. We are in 3 dimensions. We will show that X belongs to the plane generated by U and V. So we will show that X is perpendicular to Z. We will show that X is perpendicular to Z. It would then follow that X must lie on the plane generated by U and V, I'll write down the equation on the plane explicit. So the last step is to consider x dot z. I will show that this is 0. X dot z is x1 z1 plus x2 z2 plus x3 z3. Use the formulas for x1, x2, x3. So let me write z1 first. Z1 into alpha u1 plus beta v1, alpha u2 plus beta v2 plus z3 into alpha u3 plus beta v3. I have written down the formulas for x1, x2, x3 in terms of the coordinates of components of u and v. So this is take alpha outside, z1 u1 plus alpha outside, z2 u2, the last term alpha has been taken outside, z3 u3 plus the other set of terms, beta into z1 v1 plus z2 v2 plus z3 v3. But I have just now observed that these two numbers are 0, so this is 0. So x dot z is 0, that is expand. The expanded form gives me x1 z1 plus x2 z2 plus x3 z3 equal to 0, where z is a fixed vector. Z1, z2, z3 are fixed numbers. They are fixed numbers because they come, z is u cross v, u and v are fixed. The coordinates, components of u and v are fixed, so z is fixed. That is, the coordinates, components z1, z2, z3 are fixed numbers. So this is like ax1 plus bx2 plus cx3 is 0. So x lies on a plane passing through the origin. I have taken x as an arbitrary element here. So any vector in W must lie on the plane passing through the origin, okay. So we have determined all subspaces of dimension 2 in R3. Okay, so also look at the following result. What are the possible, the following result is motivated by this question. What are the possible dimensions of any subspace of a finite dimensional vector space? All integers lying between 0, 0 excluded till the dimension of V, okay. Intuitively, that's clear. Let's prove it quickly. A quick proof of this fact. Let W be a subspace of a finite dimensional vector space V. Then dimension W cannot exceed dimension of V. Dimension W cannot exceed dimension of V. Okay, intuitively this is clear. A subset cannot have a greater dimension than the superset. Proof is as follows. Let's take B to be a basis of W. Then B is linearly independent. In W, any basis must be a linearly independent spanning subset. So this is linear independent W, but linear independence in W is the same as linear independence in V. Because it doesn't depend on anything that has got to do with W. The only thing that I know is that the vectors are in W. So this means that B is, script B is a linearly independent in V. But what we know is that the number of elements in any linearly independent subset cannot exceed the dimension of the space. Okay. So the number of elements in B cannot exceed the number of cannot exceed the dimension of the space V. But this number is the dimension of W. that is dimension W is less than or equal to dimension V. Okay, so that's an easy consequence. Okay, let's now look at R3 and then list all the subspaces and their dimensions. We will use this result. Consider the vector space R3. The dimension of R3 is 3. Let W be a subspace of R3. Okay. Then by the previous theorem, what we know is that dimension of W equal to 0, 1 or 2. It can be 3 also. So let us say, let us include that and then see what happens if it is equal to 3. Dimension W 0, 1, 2 or 3. Dimension W equal to 0. This means W is singleton 0. 0 dimensional, 0 is the only vector space. Look at the other extreme. Dimension W is 3. Okay. In this case, W equal to span of B, where B has 3 elements. Okay, let us say x, y, z. If W has dimension 3, then it has 3 elements in any basis. But now look at the result that we proved today. If I have a linearly independent subset that has the same number of elements as the dimension of the vector space, then that must be a basis for that vector space. If I have a linearly independent subset having the same number of elements as the dimension of the vector space, then this must be a basis for that vector space. Okay. Using that result, it follows that B is a basis for R3. Follows that B is a basis for R3. Okay, but this means W is equal to R3. Is that okay? In this case, W must be the whole of R3.
Sir,
yes.
Dimension of W 0, 1, 2, 3. 0, 1, 2, 3.
0, 1, 2, 3. These are the 4 possibilities. The dimension of the previous result says the dimension W does not exceed dimension V. It can be equal. So these are the, yes,
so 0, 1, 2, 3 only.
Yeah, 0, 1, 2, 3. These are the 4 possibilities.
0 asterisk, it means 10 plus 1 asterisk. Dimension is 4, dimension
V has dimension 3. Dimension is a non-negative number. Dimension is 0, 1, 2, etc. up to dimension V. Dimension of R3 is 3. So it is from 0 to 3. 0 is really trivial because the only vector space which has 0 as its dimension is a 0 space. So that is anyway trivial, but we must include it here. It is a non-negative number. No? It is a number of elements in a basis, so it can be 0. So 0 should also be included, even though it is trivial. Okay. So these are the 2 extremes. If the dimension is 0, then the subspace is a trivial subspace. If the dimension is 3, the dimension of the original space, then the subspace must be equal to R3. So we are left with these 2 possibilities. Dimension is 1, dimension is 2. Dimension 2 we have disposed of. Dimension W equal to 2 we have disposed. This means W is a plane, a certain plane passing through the origin. This we proved just now. If dimension of W is 2, then W is a certain plane passing through the origin. So we are left with dimension W equal to 1. So what is your guess in that case? It must be a certain line passing through the origin. Okay. So let's dispose that off by giving a quick proof. So we want to consider the case dimension W equals 1. Let's first observe that let's first observe that if let's call something else, let's call H. Let H be the set of all X in R3 such that, let me first write down the set of all points lying on a certain line passing through the origin. Set of all X in R3 such that X1 is A times T, X2 is B times T, X3 is C times T, where A, B, C are given constants, T varies in R. A, B, C are given constants, T varies in R. We have seen this before. We have shown that this is a subspace. Okay. Now, if X belongs to H, then X1 by A equals X2 by B equals X3 by C. That is, this is a symmetric form of a line in R3. That is, X lies on a certain line passing through the origin. The direction ratios are ABC. Okay, X lies on a line through the origin. What is also clear is that if X is in H, then X can be written as X1, X2, X3, that is equal to use these equations. I will take T outside, T times ABC, I will call it T times U, T times U, where U is the vector whose components are ABC. Okay. Now, this is a non-trivial line. So, there are three constants ABC, at least one of them is not 0. So, the vector U is not 0, a single vector, non-zero, linearly independent. And what we have shown is that any X in H is a multiple of this, any X is a linear combination of this. And so, this is a basis for H. So, dimension of H is 1. What we have shown is that if the collection of all points lying on any straight line passing through the origin, that is a subspace of dimension 1. Converse, maybe I will leave it as an exercise. If H is a subspace of R3 of dimension 1, show that H is precisely the set of all points lying on a certain line passing through the origin. Okay. That is going to be an exercise for you. It then follows that we have understood all one-dimensional subspaces of R3. They are precisely lines passing through the origin. Okay, let me stop here.